Hello everyone and welcome to this new series, Learn Everything About Autodesk Insight. And today is the first episode. I'm Jad Delel with Customer Success Organization and I will be your host today. My guest speaker for this series is Ian Molloy. He's a Senior Product Manager in Rivet's team and responsible of Autodesk Insight. In this series, you will learn about integrated multidisciplinary design and how Autodesk is applying it to buildings for better outcomes. You will hear directly from Autodesk product team with Ian. You will get tips and tricks to increase your productivity. You will discover practical examples of using this smart tool and even more on this series. For your information, this presentation will be recorded and posted in the EP Hub. You will get also the link in the follow-up email you will receive from us next week. Please use the Q&A section to ask your questions and the chat window to share your feedback or comments. We will make sure also to answer most of your questions afterward and we'll follow up with the unanswered ones. Let's use the chat window now and test it if it's working. So please type yes if you know about Autodesk Insight and no if you don't. Okay, let me try here. No. All right, it looks like it's working. Perfect. Thank you for sharing. Everyone will be muted just to make sure of the quality of the audio in the recording. Now I will hand over to Ian. Ian?
Okay, great. Okay, well, hi everybody. As Jad said, my name is Ian Molloy and I'm the Senior Product Manager here at Autodesk for both Insight you're going to see today, but also Revit MEP. So you know a little bit about me. My background is actually in mechanical engineering and building science. I've been essentially developing tools like Insight and applying them in practice for my whole career now, pretty much over 20 years. And I'm really happy to be talking to you here today. As Jed said, this is part of a series and we're going to start with a pretty high level overview about really what Insight is and how to access it and the main principles of it and what it contains and so on and some sort of frequently asked questions. And then later we'll, with tips and tricks, we'll get into more hands-on things. Please do send in your questions in the chat box. We'll have time at the end to try and answer a few and if we can't get to them, we'll try and follow up after. So I'll get started here. I'm going to start with the read the big picture. Just check chat. Is that clicked forward? Okay, you see that?
Yes, it's working.
Okay, thanks for confirming. So just a really big picture. You know, to start with, why is Insight important to begin with? We all know working in the AEC industry, the very significant role that buildings play in terms of their use of raw materials, energy, and production of carbon. It's no secret that buildings have the single largest share of that globally. There are many, many different sets of goals and targets and initiatives globally, but one of the simplest and most tangible in our minds is comes from Architecture 2030, and it essentially calls for a series of increasing targets that get the AC industry to carbon neutral by 2030. The other thing we really like about it is that thanks to the AIA and their 2030 commitment, which collects data on the industry's progress towards this, we can see where we're at today, which is around 440, rounding to the nearest number, around 40%. So we've still got a lot of work to do, but this is very much a sign of an industry in transition. But it's really great. We actually have the data to see how we're tracking towards that. Now, the key to really achieving this, there's lots of tactics, but sort of strategically, you can look at it as being integrated design. We all know that the earlier we can make better decisions and make decisions as a, you know, collective group between your architect, engineer, and owner. We'll make better decisions that provide better value, and ultimately we can get a higher performance at lower cost. So at a very high level, that's what we mean by integrated multidisciplinary design. That's the goal, that's the ideal. And all of us working, we're always trying to optimize that process. That's essentially what Insight tries to help with. It's not the entire answer, but it plays a very significant role, especially around energy and other aspects of building comfort and so on. And it really does present a tremendous opportunity for the building industry to do a lot better, because there's a lot of untapped potential, not only in new construction, but also in existing buildings. So what I'm going to talk about today is a set of tools that essentially help with more integrated design. And that's what you're going to sort of learn about. So to start with real basics, you know, in terms of like what actually Insight is, at its core, essentially the way to look at it is from any Revit model, or you can also think about format at a conceptual design stage, you can get an accurate picture of how much energy that building is going to use in its location, given its weather and its overall building design. And then you can use that to essentially optimize to get to a better place. So you can look at building form, the envelope, systems, hours of operation, any aspect that drives building energy. Understanding it is the key to optimizing it, and that's essentially what Insight does. It's a building energy model. In addition to that, there are some other aspects of Insight that provide kind of sub pieces to the energy picture. Each one is interesting information and data in its own right and can be used for specific decisions. But we like to think of them as a sort of a subset of the building energy, because the building energy sort of touches all aspects of not just the building design, the climate, and other interactions around the building occupancy and things like that. But the other components of it are solar radiation, daylighting, and heating and cooling calculations. And the way you'll actually see this sort of manifest itself in Revit today, it's worth understanding this because it's not always clear to people, is that first of all, the energy component actually is installed with Revit. It's a part of Revit. And it actually appears as what we call energy optimization for Revit. It was previously known as energy analysis for Revit, but because we've enhanced it significantly, we've sort of renamed it. And it'll also depend on what version of Revit that you're using. So if you're on Revit 2017 onwards, all you need to do is look for the Analyze panel, and then you'll find it under energy optimization. And that's everywhere where you create the energy model and run the analyses and look at the results. The other component to Insight, essentially there's three, but they're all part of a separate plugin that you need to download and install. Sometimes people either overlook that or they mix up one with the other and they're not quite sure what they're looking at. But the other part of that, as I said, is a separate plugin, and that provides the three tools that I mentioned earlier. So it's worth just bearing that in mind. That's just the way it will appear. And I will point out when I'm later in the software exactly where the tools appear. Sometimes in some people's installs, it's not enabled by default. And I can show you where that actually is. Okay. So that's essentially the basics of, you know, what Insight is. It's essentially building energy and indoor environmental modeling. It is a part of it is essentially installed with and ships with Revit, and a part of it is a plugin. All of this, everything you see here, is essentially part of a Revit or AC subscription feature. Okay, and we get asked this a lot. I'll come to it later about how much it costs. Essentially, nothing. It's included as part of your subscription. There's only one part of daylighting that can consume cloud credits due to the way it is built on A360 rendering. I'll get into that in a little bit more detail later on. But basically, any of you now who have a Revit or AC collection subscription have these tools, and they're very valuable. And we want you to sort of learn how to be able to leverage these, you know, as part of your process to help, you know, win projects, do projects, and so on. So that's the purpose of what we're. Thing I thought worth starting with was really to talk about, like, well, how is Insight different? Because the reality is there are actually hundreds of tools like Insight in terms of what they do in terms of energy or daylighting or thermal comfort. And our friends at the International Building Performance Simulation Association, IBPSA, have this on a website called Building Energy Software Tools. And if you look at it, it lists, they keep a kind of a library of all the different tools that are available for different types of energy or comfort or daylighting type analysis. And you can see that they actually list 177 different, individually different tools. It's pretty amazing. And you can get lost in this website. And there's lots of really cool stuff in here. Notice we're platinum sponsor of IBPSA. And this list was formerly hosted by the Department of Energy, and IBPSA have taken it over. But anyway, this on its own is worth taking a look. You'll find our tools in there and other tools that, you know, work with Revit and so on, and you can filter them different ways. But the key thing I wanted to point here was that there are 177 tools, let alone, you know, the different ways that people handle this themselves with things like, you know, a spreadsheet, or even increasingly things like Dynamo or custom workflows and things like that with Grasshopper or whatever it might be. There's lots of ways to try to provide this information. So given all of that, given the, you know, magnitude of these and the complexity of some of these tools and the strengths, different strengths and weaknesses of them, how is Insight different? What is the unique value and differentiation that it actually provides? So if I was to use one word to actually answer that question, it would be this. It's not really a word, it's three letters. You all know exactly what it means. My reason for choosing this was to say BIM is that not just merely in terms of its relationship with Revit. We all know that BIM is about a lot more than just Revit. It's really about the process and how BIM is a process, you know, and in terms of progression of design from concept to detail and creation of documentation, as well as stakeholder collaboration and communication, and the whole thing that it encompasses, really sort of a representation of the design, another term for the design process. Insight is different in that it's specifically designed not only to provide that information, but to integrate with your process and integrate with your tools and provide the information you need at the time that you need it, right? And in a very open and easy and accessible way. Obviously, an integration and with Revit is a very significant component, but that's essentially it at a high level. To kind of explain that more, if we look at building energy as an example, we can kind of see, I can sort of explain a little bit about what we mean by that. If you look at any of the existing kind of tools today, their strengths are also some of their sort of their weaknesses as well, right? And there's a few different aspects to them. The first thing is that they predominantly focus on a single position of performance, a single point of performance at very high precision. And that's a great strength, but it's also a weakness, because in that respect, when you get to that level of precision, it can become cumbersome, and it can also, the more detail a model can get, it can also become more prone to error and so on. So the reason for the exclamation marks here is that you just need to exercise care when doing these things, that they require quite a bit of skill. They're also mostly, because of that sort of precision, they're also mostly applicable at a DD or documentation design stage when the design is more or less already done. Because those tools require a lot of detailed input, you don't know that information until you get to the DD stage, after which you've missed the opportunity to kind of make the decisions. They're also very much targeted at the specialist or broadly sort of MEP engineer. They have a lot of very specific domain knowledge, and they're not the easiest things to use, right? Also, they require an entirely separate model. Each tool, each type of analysis has its own set of inputs, not just in terms of, you know, metadata, but geometry and how they take off the building. And as a result, you know, they really do tend to only be applied to like special projects. So projects where the time and the budget sort of allows and or, you know, the skills are available. So they're more of a sort of, they're still in a sort of a niche, and they haven't really sort of scaled to a large degree. Now, not to say that these tools don't have a value, they really do. There wouldn't be 177 of them existing if each of them didn't provide a specific need. But in their entirety, especially, you know, from the outside and people sort of getting started in this area or wanting to really try to provide maximum value in this area at minimum effort, these things kind of get in the way, right? And they provide barriers to that. What Insight does that's different around that is that it focuses on solving different problems or different sides of that problem. So where existing tools focus on a single position at very high precision, Insight focuses on direction and accuracy. In other words, not only where you're at, but where you can go and how you can make it, you know, better or worse, and the things that matter. It's also very accurate because of the approach that it takes using ranges, and it doesn't assume certain things to be right when it doesn't know those inputs. In other words, it embraces uncertainty. It actually improves the accuracy of the overall direction that it's giving. It's not only applicable to detailed design, it can start from as early as conceptual design stage in day one, where you're really looking at just massing and, you know, broad concept around the building through the programming, all the way through to detailed design. It's much more inclusive. It's not only aimed at the specialist, but architects can use it, engineers can use it, and you can even use it to have a conversation with a client about what's important, why it's important, what the trade-offs and decisions are, and so on, and it can be used very interactively to kind of help make the right decision. There's no separate model. It just uses the same model. It's truly BIM-based. And the whole point of this is that it really is aimed at providing a level of guidance on every project. The level of effort and time, skill that's required to this is significantly lower, and the value that it provides is significantly higher. So that they're really the key things that differentiate it from tools. And as I said, each of those tools, they all have their different strengths and weaknesses. But Insight is really about targeting the process and making it frictionless in terms of how to integrate it in terms of whether it be conceptual, schematic. So that's it at a very high level. I'm going to jump in now and give you a very quick demonstration. It's really just a walkthrough, and I really want to focus on some of the key principles of Insight that kind of show everything I've just talked about there. If you want a more kind of detailed picks and clicks demonstration, there's a link here on YouTube. We have a recording of a quick introduction to Insight and Revit's analysis tools. And you can take a look at that. For now, I'm just going to provide a very, very quick overview of it. So there's really two sides to this. One part is in Revit itself, and then the other part is in Insight. And I'm going to start in Insight, and I'm going to show the energy model. I'm going to show the other tools later. So the first thing that you really start with is just the geometry itself. Okay, and I've got three examples here showing different stages in the design process. They can also be different levels of modeling detail. So this is sort of, you know, consistent with a very early massing level. This is, it's literally just a mass. There's any windows on the building yet. This is a schematic model. You know, there's just, you're starting to flesh out, you know, your key designs of the exterior envelope, curtain walling, feature elevations, things like that. We haven't sort of even done any room layout yet. This is all the way up to fully DD model with rooms and spaces and ceilings and all that rich detail that is in a full model. So this isn't just about the design process. This also reflects, you know, a level of, you know, flexibility in terms of how you can represent physicality. And what you see is that for each one of these, there's a separate view showing the energy model. So the top line is natural, normal architectural modeling. You're not expected to do anything different. In the past, you had to model very specifically, very cleanly to create an energy model. And that's just not the way people model in reality, right? Revit models are created for all kinds of other reasons that don't require, you know, perfectly lined up walls or, you know, closed shells and so on. And this doesn't require this anymore. You'll basically see that the energy model is completely automated. So when you pick your model and you go to analyze, you click on create energy model. I should actually just show you here. This is one important tip that I'll share now, is that sometimes people don't see the energy optimization tools, because in the user interface down the bottom explains a lot of the time why people haven't discovered Insight. So many more tips like that in the next session, but for now I'll just keep going through this. So once you have your model, all you need to do is click on create the energy model. You'll see it already says delete here because it's already present. And if I just sort of expand this one, I'll just show you what it actually contains very quickly. So basically this is a view that's been created, and from all of the architectural elements, walls, floors, roofs, windows, etc., with or without rooms or spaces, it creates these analytical model categories called spaces and surfaces. So if we look at what spaces are, you'll see basically these are just the individual kind of volumes of air that are going to heat up and cool down based on interaction with the outside and interaction with HVAC systems and occupancy and lighting and so on. They're all completely automatically identified. And then the analytical surfaces are essentially the paths of heat transfer between those surfaces. That's essentially what an energy model geometry is. the takeoff of the areas and volumes of the building, and then all the surfaces and their paths of heat transfer. It's all completely automatically generated. It's essentially a one-to-one takeoff of your physical model. So whatever level of detail your architectural model is at is the level of detail your energy model is at. And that's a big deal, because typically creating an energy model was a separate process, and it was generally one of simplification, which is okay if you know what you're doing. But that's all completely automated in Revit now. And if you know basic architectural modeling in Revit, you can create an energy model very quickly. There's one little piece of help that I would point you to, which we can cover in tips and tricks next time. But you can find that if you just search for Revit energy optimization help, you'll find that. So essentially, from there, once you have your energy model created, you can submit the model to Insight for analysis. The only thing we would sort of always ensure you do or recommend you do is set your location. That's a very easy thing to do. Just set your location on the planet. It doesn't have to be super precise. It will pick a nearby weather station, and that will provide the hourly climate data for a full year of energy simulation, which is what gets analyzed. So from here then, also to use this feature, you need to be signed in, obviously, to Revit with your A360 account, linked to a subscription. So that's how it works. And then from here, once I click on generate, it will send my analytical model and say, use the existing one, or do I want to regenerate it? From there, it actually runs in the background to Green Building Studio. So that's still very much in existence. That is the cloud-based service to be used to run and store either the DO2 or Energy Plus simulations. And then Insight is essentially a new interface for interacting with those simulations and with that data to understand the guidance that it provides. So in order to look at that, you get it in a browser. It works very much like cloud rendering if you used it before. When you submit the analysis, it will send you an email, say, hey, we received the analysis. And then when it runs, when it completes, it will send you an email to say it's returned or it's complete. And then you can click on that and open the link. Depending on the model size and complexity, that'll take anything from a minute or two to maybe an hour or two. Sometimes it can take many hours if the queue gets really backed up, but we're always working on making that fast. More often than not, it's generally a few minutes. But the thing I wanted to show you here in Insight was this really fundamental principle. The modeling geometry, you should be able to get your head around pretty quickly. It's pretty straightforward, actually. From all my experience of both developing and demonstrating Insight, there's one particular aspect of how Insight works that consistently trips people up, and it consistently trips people up who've done some analysis in the past. And that is, where are my inputs? And this whole question of, black box and, garbage in, garbage out, all those concerns. And they're very genuine concerns. So how do we answer that? Because the first thing people ask is that, okay, well, I've set my location. I've got some geometry. That's great. Where do I set all my thermal properties of walls and glazing and, office versus meeting room versus circulation area and then systems and things like that? And certainly in other tools, you have to set all that information up front in order to get a single simulation out. Where Insight is different is that no matter what is in your model, that gets simulated, but then also every other possible alternative of each of those inputs is also simulated. So when you get to Insight, you get to see and you get to set anything that matters. So when you look at Insight here, quick navigation of things, we've got our energy cost, energy range, which is we're in cost at the moment. So we can have either EUI, energy use intensity, or we can have energy cost. I like cost because it speaks to more people understand it, have a feel for what it is. And what it does is it provides this very clear indicator of how you're doing, red, orange, green. Red is above code, orange is above code, and green is when you hit the Architecture 2030 goal. But what it does is instead of essentially providing you a single number of here's how much energy you use and breaking it down in great detail, what it actually does is it identifies all the things that are most important and the sensitivity of essentially every input to the overall energy. And a good example to give that, like I said, people often ask about, hey, what about my thermal properties? Yes, there are some defaults in Revit, and I can get very detailed on that. But the point is I don't have to do that from the outset. Let me show you this example. So for example, in each of those models there in the background, yes, there are some default construction properties. And whatever they are, they'll appear in Insight at the point of that triangle. That triangle there is the BIM setting. It's whatever's in the Revit model, okay? And in wall construction here, if I've just submitted this and I was to look at this for the first time, because I haven't I don't know if I've necessarily set any particular thermal properties, it will actually show me the full range of thermal properties here of wall construction. And people tend to think, well, what is each one? And it's not a matter of what each one is. What this is, what we've ran here, is a full range of properties. So in other words, any wall type that you can think of exists somewhere on this curve. And all we need to do to see its overall value and importance is just explore this range. We can actually see that the worst performing, in other words, a totally uninsulated wall would be here, and a very highly insulated wall would be here. So from $2.79 to $2.48. So 30 cents a square foot over 15% of energy is a function of the wall insulation. And I can see here where my sort of law of diminishing returns is. I can see after this point here, 242, I'm talking like a cent now. I'm literally in, you know, lower percentage decimal places here that really, you know, probably doesn't justify the investment. But the point here is that by moving this bar around is equivalent to setting it in Revit. So even though this little triangle here, that's what's in Revit, whatever's in Revit, by me setting this to, let's say, uninsulated, would be exactly the same. I'll get exactly the same numbers if I went back here and set all the walls in Revit to uninsulated. And that's the key principle of Insight. No matter what's in your model, we'll always show you where your model sits and we'll show you the range of possibilities, meaning you get very rapid feedback on any aspect at any stage, what its overall impact is. So the idea is you can use this from day one for very early targeting to simply say, okay, if we're going to go with code, we're going to be somewhere in the middle, right? If this was an existing building and it was old, badly performing walls, it's going to be somewhere here or here. Notice like 272, 275, that's all, you know, we're still in a very accurate range and we're working in low precision. That's the fundamental principle of the paradigm. Alternatively, we could be saying, hey, we're targeting high performance or we're going to really, you know, push the envelope, no pun intended, in this case here, very high performance. And so here we can see if we were to put in an OR50 or OR60 wall, we'd get this level of savings. If I went back to Revit now and specified all walls to be OR50 or OR60 and ran it again, that triangle would have moved over to the right-hand side next time I ran it. So from a single model, from simply setting the location, from any level of model geometry detail, I get this rich data set of potential points of performance that I can explore. Each one of these is a discrete individual simulation. And what Insight is doing is an additional layer of calculation to give you what that range is. And for any aspect, whether it be the big levers like orientation or window to wall ratio or shading, all the way through to some of the more nuanced things like envelope or down to the other big things like lighting, power density, occupancy, even HVAC systems, you know, you can see the overall effect on building energy and get your overall target and move, continuously move forward. And like I said, you can apply it at any stage. So that's really the key principle of Insight. The idea being is that you can start with very little information, you can work your way through decisions, you can start with big uncertainty and move towards reducing that uncertainty, making decisions, and then the whole time, you know, as necessary, you know, documenting those decisions in your model. That's really what the Revit model becomes, right, in the end, is a documentation of the design decisions. So when you get through to your detailed design, and you can do this at any stage in any one of these models, we can get through here and we can pick a wall or wall type, we can set its thermal properties, we can set room properties, all that information. I'll cover a lot of that in tips and tricks as well as to how to do that information. But essentially, there's almost no aspect of space and thermal properties that you can't get to a very high degree of specification in the Revit model by embedding that information. And there's various ways to do that. So I'm going to jump back now to the PowerPoint. I'll continue moving here. So just in the sake of time, I'm going to stick in PowerPoint to explain some of these other tools. A lot of these other tools are a lot simpler than the energy tools. So you'll be able to appreciate them just through PowerPoint. So to start with solar radiation, again, in a very similar way, it can scale from conceptual all the way through to detail. So starting with just some conceptual massing, you can pick some surfaces and calculate essentially the incident solar radiation on them. So what this accounts for is, this says based on my location, based on my weather data, and based on my geometry, it will calculate the incident solar radiation either at an individual point in time or over a year or for a peak day, whatever you want. And then from there, you can also calculate photovoltaic potential. And that's essentially what's been calculated here. Here's the incident solar radiation on these surfaces. And here's the amount of photovoltaic generated from those surfaces. There's also some payback calculations it can do for you as well. And so, like I said, you can work with this using the revogeometry from conceptual. You can see a very simple example here. Well, what if we added in some trees? This is a nice example here. You can see how that actually reduces the photovoltaic energy production ever so slightly, causes a small bit of shading on that surface there. And in the same respect, you can advance that. Given a broad understanding, if we're trying to hit a certain maybe net zero target and we need a certain amount of PV, certain percentage of the roof, you can account for that both in Insight and also in the Insight Energy and also the solar radiation. And then you can move towards an actual PV design, right? In this case here, we have some actual panels. We can do different arrays of spacing and sizes, and we can do the same calculation at that level of detail and determine the level of payback between the two options. So it's another really good example of how, you know, we can scale our level of detail. If you think about it again, to use this as an example, a lot of existing tools would require you to model to this level of detail before you could run an analysis. Where simply by being able to select a surface or even broadly say 80% of roof, we can calculate the PV potential. So you can get that information from day one on what the overall opportunities are. Very, very powerful. I've obviously focused a lot here on photovoltaic, but you can also use it in a general sense of just solar radiation due to shading on fenestration or a particular part of a building or in a courtyard or something like that. It's multiple applications you can put it to. In a similar sort of vein, but in a very different way, daylighting can also be simulated inside the building. That this whole feature is essentially built on A360 rendering in the cloud. There is a mode that runs illuminance calculations. And again, so in this case, it's also using the location, it's using the weather and the geometry, but also in this case, the material information. So all the reflectivity and transmittance of glass and so on is all accounted for. And there's multiple different types of daylighting studies that you can do here from individual points in time through to, you know, automated lead calculations and also, you know, totally customizable sort of periods of time and combinations of setting and materials and outputs and so on. So it's a very flexible and powerful way of looking at daylighting and using the native Revit geometry. So again, there is no separate model here. There's no simplification of the model. You're using all the curtain panels and their mullions, all things that would normally be simplified in a separate rebuilding of the model. There's no need to do that. It can even account for furniture and things like that and trees if you've got them. So the daylighting aspect of this is another very important part of the equation. And it can be used, like I said, in multiple sort of aspects. The most popular that we see is for the LEED daylighting credits, mainly because there's a lot of documentation to be created for them. And this can all automate that and do it directly from your model. So one of the key aspects of doing that is creating a schedule for each room and being able to set, you know, whether it's included in the calculation, whether it has automatic shading, and doing that overall calculation of whether it meets the pass-fail criteria. I should mention that just back here, it does all versions of LEED. So that includes the most recent version of LEED has the most stringent and new set of metrics for daylighting, which is spatial daylight autonomy and annual sunlight exposure. It does that in its entirety, but you can also break it down. You can do them separately through this whole customizable settings. So it's a very flexible thing. We try to make it as easy as possible from a push button to do a whole building analysis, but also be able to break your analysis down. And that's, we generally see people use that in design. They'll maybe analyze a level or a set of rooms, and then they'll wait for a later stage when they want to do the documentation to generate everything together. And then finally, we have the heating and cooling loads. Now, you'll see part of this data actually appears in Insight. That's the information on the left-hand side here. And then the other part of it actually, you will receive it back in Revit and just your sort of report and data form. But what this is actually providing here is where the energy side is running, you know, full annual hourly simulation, so 8,760 hours of climate data for the whole year and predicting the overall energy. What the heat and cooling loads are doing are peak design days, and it uses energy plus heat balance method to understand, to do essentially dynamic heating, peak heating and cooling loads. And then we use the little viewer and insight to essentially look at those peak loads. So you can pick on any individual space, you'll see it's color coded. And again, in this model here, it's no surprise that the big curvy glass curtain wall space has the highest heating and the highest cooling load, south facing as well. But what this allows you to do is get a very quick indication of, you know, any individual areas that are subject to over or under heating, as well as a good way to communicate to a client, actually, interestingly, what an energy simulation is, because an energy simulation is this over time, plus the systems that need to actually serve that heating and cooling. So it's a good way to understand a little bit more about what that does. Also, critically as well, it's one of the fundamental starting blocks for any system sizing and selection. For HVAC and understanding central plant needs, boilers, chillers, and things like that, as well as sort of space by space needs. So that's another sort of thing that's just included as part of when you run an energy simulation. We also calculate heating and cooling loads. You can present them in Insight, and you can also then view that. I would finish up with is a series of frequently asked questions. So again, Insight has been out over 2 years now, and we were obviously developing it for a long period, had a lot of input over time. And you know, in those 2 years, these kind of, in no particular order, relate to some of the most commonly asked questions that I get. So I'll just go through them one by one here. It'll be interesting to see if this matches with any of the questions that are in the Q&A. I haven't had a chance to look yet. So the first one is can Insight be used for code compliance, green building rating, e.g. LEED? So the answer is that yes, it can be used to inform a lot of these things and provide documentation for some components like the daylighting, but broadly it is not intended for code compliance push button, there's my ASHRAE 90.1 or all my LEED documentation. No such thing really exists, to be fair. No magic button for LEED exists. What Insight really focuses on, where compliance and green rating is really about rating, essentially a DD level design, and sort of rating that. Insight is really about informing design. So it's providing simpler metrics that really show, remember I mentioned about not only position, but also direction. And there's different things you can take from this, and people have used Insight to accelerate certain parts of their process, like in the case of daylighting, it can do it all. But for energy modeling, they're using it for the integrated design, credited as the early stage, as well as just an overall ballpark estimate of where they might sit on the scale relative to lead points. I think the most common thing that we've seen is that they're really using Revit and Insight and the GBXML export or DO2 or Energy Plus export to bring into another tool like eQuest or Design Builder or IES to actually run the actual code compliance calculation. So we're not trying to replace those tools and the stage in the process that they're typically done. We're trying to provide something a little bit higher level and more applicable to more projects. Next one is what engine or engines does Insight use and has it been validated? So there's a couple of answers to this. On the energy side, there's two answers. One is computational and one is practical. On the computational side, we run DO2 or Energy Plus, you have the choice. Both of which have been tested and documented against ASHRAE 140. So that's all the sort of table stakes for any building energy analysis tool has to be able to show that. And we've done that. And it compares just the same to any other tool that you would see, right? On the practical side, in terms of, you know, speaking from our user's experience and comparing it to actual building energy, we've had very, very good results. And this speaks to the basis of, we're not just running single simulations, but we're actually running ranges. And by embracing uncertainty and so on, you're actually able to not only get at a more accurate model, but also understand where the difference may lie. So we've seen many, many customers have really positive experiences where they've compared it to past projects, where they've done, you know, what they would call a full energy model and had very, very similar results. And we've also seen cases where there's been discrepancies between the Insight model and the engineer's model, only to find that actually the engineer's model hasn't captured the architecture properly and so on. So it's a really good way to close the gap between those two tools. So again, yeah, very good validation on the energy side, and there's good trust and confidence has been a really key thing for us. That's not to say that you can't make mistakes in using it still. You got to read the manual and things like that, but it still overall is a lot more effective and you know, we've not only made it easier, but we've also made it better. On the daylighting side, we use A360 rendering, which is a cloud-based engine that uses what's called bidirectional ray tracing, very specific method. And we've tested that engine essentially against radiance and real-world measurements and had very good results on that. And on the solar side, we use what's called the Perez Sky model, and it's been tested by the National Renewable Energy Lab, and that's also all good. So yes, we have, you know, we use all the kind of like the best engines that you can get, and we've tested them against the sort of the standard table stakes thing that you're meant to do for validation. And we've also had very good feedback with, just read some of our case studies, I would suggest, online. Just again, Google Insight, Autodesk Insight case studies, and you'll find them. Where does Green Building Studio fit in? So some of you may or may not know what that is. You know, that's essentially the cloud-based service for running and storing the simulation. So that's still there. You can go to gbs.autodesk.com and you can sign in. You'll be able to see the individual simulations that are run. There's a much, much richer data set for each individual simulation that's run. But essentially, Insight is a new skin that sits on top of that, that reads those few hundred simulations and calculates this energy range. In other words, the combinatoric effect of all those hundreds of simulations, what would that, the net result of that be? But Green Building Studio is still there, and there's lots of information that you get. There's more, even further climate information you can get, even further energy use breakdown information you can get. It's more of an advanced thing, but it's still very much in the picture and very much a key part of what we do. We just don't require you to go there to look at the results anymore. And again, if you're getting started, don't start there. Start with just Revit and Insight, and you can kind of graduate to understanding what's in Green Building Studio. Does Insight account for HVAC systems? So the short answer to this is yes, it does. There is a factor in Insight for HVAC systems. And again, following the paradigm of what Insight does is it essentially provides a range of HVAC systems so that you understand the overall impact on building energy. The purpose of that is not to pick a specific individual system or zoning strategy or whatever it might be. It's just to understand that there is that's going to be an impact, and that curve and the extent of it, the slope of it, represents that overall range. So in the same way, almost any system that's possible sits somewhere on that range. And in that respect, it does account for HVAC systems, and you can understand whether you're in high, medium, and low, and the impact that will have on performance. What it does not allow you to do, Revit or Insight does not allow you to do, is get in and go to the very high level of detail that traditional energy modeling tools do. Right? For that, we would suggest, you know, you can export other tools, you can run them in those tools, and you'll actually see very comparable numbers. That's another aspect of the validation that we've seen people do, because underneath it, you know, we're still using the same engines, DOTU or Energy Plus. It's another good example to sort of say that's where we provide good accuracy but low precision. We don't allow you to get into high precision on the HVAC systems. So some mechanical engineers find that disappointing, but again, we're not trying to replace a lot of the existing tools. They're still valid. What we're really trying to do is provide something that is faster and more nimble, more applicable to early stages and that architects can use, or even the mechanical engineer can use to have a conversation with the whole design team about the role that HVAC systems play and how important they are, and really the need for further investigation into those things, where from which you can use a lot of the information that comes out of Insight. Which really brings me to my next point: what data can I export from Revit and Insight? So I mentioned earlier, both on the Revit and Insight side, we can export GBXML, DOTU, and Energy Plus, which really supports a lot of really all of the main tools. The thing to just watch out for is that, you know, that GBXML can come in a variety of different forms, and those tools can often expect it in a different format as well. So you need to understand sort of the nuances between those things and some of the different workflows that are there. In addition to those exports, you can also export all the graphics and data from Insight in tabular Excel form, and as well as you can also export to the AIA 2030 DDX as well. That's built into Insight. There's another really popular one. What countries is Insight applicable to? Is it only for the US? Somewhat, maybe mistakenly, we give the impression that it maybe is only US specific, but in fact, it's not. We believe Insight is globally applicable because buildings at the end of the day use energy for the same reasons all over the world, right? It's climate, it's, you know, architecture and materials, it's internal occupancy, and it's systems. It's that combination. And Insight can map out that whole landscape and understand what the most important drivers are. The things that are a little more US-centric, as you'll see, is that in order to give you that red, orange, green scale, we use the ASHRAE baseline for that. So that's the one thing that is sort of US specific. It is used outside. But one of the reasons we use that is that, you know, it's actually one of the clearer standards and data sets there are that you can use in a whole building energy simulation, right? A lot of other codes and standards really only designate, you know, certain levels of performance. They don't have a simulation-based code approach, not all of them at least. So also as well, it has support for other currencies and you can use metric and things like that. So you can absolutely apply it outside, and we see many, many people do that. Just not immediately obvious is the answer. How much does it cost? I touched on this earlier. You know, this is included as part of your Revit or AEC collection subscription. So everything you've seen, energy, solar, heating, cooling, there's no additional cost for it. Daylighting is the one exception to it because it's built in A360 rendering. Above a certain threshold, it will start to ask for cloud credits. And it's really a function of, you know, how big a model you want to run, how many floors, you're actually, how many levels and rooms and things you're actually creating the model against. So it has a formula for calculating that. What we see a lot of people do is that they can work well, easily under the threshold in the design phases, like on a room by room or level by level basis. And it's not until you need to do a whole building daylighting simulation for documentation or for co-compliance, do you need to rack up, you know, a number of cloud credits. And it tends to be pretty low, like 30 or 40 credits or something like that, is what that involves. But in every other respect, it doesn't use cloud credits. And that's essentially it. So I'm going to pass it back to Jad for Q&A and closing.
So we have a really lot of questions here. So, and I know we still have like 15 minutes here. So I will invite you in just to look into the Q&A section, but I have a few of them, maybe one quick here from Phil regarding the outputs, the results, units. So he's asking about the pound. So I know we can do euros, we can do the dollar and the units, but what about the pound for the UK?
Is it it's there yet?
It possible?
I mean, there's a few different aspects. Remember, this is a real overview today. You need to look a bit deeper in here. But just on that one, in Insight, for each grouping of models that you have, basically think of this Insight demo as a project, or it could be a project stage. You have these settings, and in here you'll see the currency, and you should see GBP. There you go there, right? Yeah, so once I click on that, one thing it will do, it will ask me for what the electricity and gas rate is, because for in order to calculate energy cost, we need to know. So we need to put in, you know, it's, what is it these days in the UK, like 15 pence or 12 pence a kilowatt hour or whatever it is for gas. So once you put that in, it'll calculate based on that.
Perfect. Perfect. Thank you, Ian. Can you maybe just check the Q&A section? So you have like few questions there. One question from Nick Pierce. Is it relevant to distinguish interior and exterior walls as being insulated? So,
that's a great question. So, actually, no. A lot of other analysis tools require you to be very prescriptive about the nature of your Revit model. As in, you know, this is an exterior wall. You know, use the wall function to designate its type and so on. Insight is a lot smarter than that, because, you know, what this is, it's built to work with real architectural models, and a lot of people, especially early on, don't always, more often than not, designate those things, right? You can very easily have an exterior wall interior, like I'm going to do here, right? And What Insight actually does, in fact, it's not Insight, this is actually Revit. This is built into Revit and the sort of smarts in Revit. I'm just drawing a very simple little box here so you can see what happens. Just a second more, won't take long. Make it flat so we can see it nice and clear. I'll get into this more in tips and tricks around really the model creation piece, but watch this, right? So in this model here, that interior wall, is actually
are you sharing something in, because I'm
I realized you're taking the share back.
So you can maybe you can just take it back. Sorry.
Yeah, this is a very quick one, right? So just in line, no, wireframe, right? So can you see that, Jad? Yeah?
Yep, I can
that
see it.
That wall in there actually has a type function exterior, right? I don't have to set that because when I create the energy model, just make this nice and clear, create the energy model. What you'll actually see when it does that, when it that analytical surface, when I get it, hang on. Actually will realize that it's actually type analytical surface type interior. So it's very, very smart around that. So basically that whole algorithm figures out any combination of walls, floors, roofs, gaps, overlaps, what is a reasonably enclosed space without having to use spaces. So you can model very roughly and it will do the right thing in terms of analytical model creation. That's the whole point of it. We don't want you to have to create a separate model. Even if it's within Revit, you know, you should just be able to create, you should just author architecture, walls, floors, roofs, windows, you know, curtain walls, masses, any combination of that. Again, if you watch that video, that longer video, I go into more depth on that.
Excellent. So I have another question here from Joanne. What is the difference between the heating and cooling loads, which was always there within Revit MEP?
Oh, that's a good one. Yeah. So the original one in Revit MEP, basically, first of all, it required you to place rooms or spaces, which required you to have properly bounded elements and then set their heights and things like that, which really didn't work with real architectural models. If you rebuilt the model, remodeled it cleanly, it would work, but it didn't work with real architectural models. And then the calculation engine itself was a very basic radiant time series calculation, one of the ASHRAE methods, but very, very basic. It's quasi-dynamic is what it's called. It's not fully dynamic. With Insight's heating and cooling loads, it uses essentially the new analytical model. So very flexible with geometry, very tolerant of real architectural models, directly translates that into the underlying basis. The energy model is the heating and cooling load model. And then Energy Plus itself uses the heat balance method, which is a much more sophisticated, much more accurate method for determining cooling loads and heating loads. So that's the main difference.
Excellent. Another question from Truls here. Can you set wall properties in simulation to your thermal properties like U value? I think it's possible in Revit, but I let you confirm.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mentioned this earlier. Just remember, you know what I mean? A lot of people think that they have to set all this up front in order to get a valid simulation. But remember that whatever's in your Revit model, Insight will vary anyway, and you can set it in Insight, and then energy EUI or cost will reflect as if you had set it in Revit. The main reason you would do it in Revit is that if you had different wall types, right? Like one wall type is this type and one wall type is another. So if I go into Revit, I'll show you where you do that. But well, first of all, there's three ways to do it. If you go into the advanced settings, you'll see under material thermal properties, there's three settings: conceptual, schematic, and detailed. And the conceptual is the default. The conceptual actually has, like, for each major type, there's about six or so high, medium, low performance you can pick from. If you go into the schematic, you'll see, again, for each major type, you've got about 60 or so you can pick from. And you can edit that file as well, meaning you don't have to create any detailed properties. The most advanced way to do it is by turning that on and selecting an element, or you don't have to do it in this order, select an element, go into the elements layer, and then set its material properties. You'll notice at the moment it has no U value. But if I actually add in a thermal asset, you'll see here some specific capacity density. It will take that material and apply it to the thickness and give you the R value of that material. So I can create a layered structure. And that's exactly the same information that goes into a traditional energy model. So very flexible ways to go from sort of conceptual schematic to an actual type. Same goes for windows and curtain walls. I can embed the solar heat gain coefficient, the U value, and the visible light transmittance on the curtain panels and the windows in the same way.
Excellent. Another question here from Joey. Is Insight going to be tied to BIM 360?
I don't know the answer to that. I mean, like, not in the short to medium term. There's no particular, you know, BIM 360. I suppose in the long term, yeah, you know, with BIM 360 being a broader move of Autodesk things to the cloud, you could kind of think of Insight as a BIM 360 type service. It's just, you know, Autodesk, we kind of create, in the past, at least, we've created these separate products and product lines to sort of serve particular needs and personas, and so they're sort of currently separate. So let me put this way, in theory, they're essentially the same sort of thing, right? At different stages, they're cloud-based and so on. But right now, as a product line or product, they're separate. So I hope that sort of answers your question. I'm interested to know why you asked that and what aspect of it do you see the merger being, right? Is it purely a positioning one, or is it more of a technical one?
We can follow up with Joey afterward for sure. Yeah. So another question here from Joanne. When can we expect new functionalities in Insight 360? So maybe you can clarify Insight 360 and Insight also for the audience as well.
Good point. You know, so actually, I think it was about a year ago, we dropped the 360 piece from the name, just called it Insight. But it's still the same thing, right? It's just a simplification of the naming. Great question about the new features. So like I said, Insight is about 2 years old, and pretty much over the past year, we haven't actually added any new features to it because all of our efforts have been on optimizing the back end, right, in terms of how fast it runs, how reliable it is, and also improving the accuracy of it. And we've continued to do that. We've reached a pretty good place with that, and that really now we're starting to look at some new features. We'd need to be in a different venue to start to talk about them, but all it says is just watch the Revit roadmap in the next while to start to talk about some of the areas. So the little hint is expansion into more HVAC system side of things, and not turning Insight into a sort of a detailed tool or getting away from its simplicity, but giving people more level of precision on that level of system definition and so on is one major area that we've been asked a lot about, and it's no mystery that that's where we're focusing next. So a lot more to come, though. But we realize we've been kind of quiet on that front for a while. As always, I'd love to hear what is of interest to you and what you'd like to hear us do, because we do listen, and we just sort of like listen to put it all together and what are the most common requests and so on. So I'd be interested in hearing that. But like I said, lots more to come. Watch this space over the next while.
All right. Can you maybe answer the last question here from Joanne? So Joanne is asking, so Insight is calculating, so it's a long question, but I will read it here. Insight is calculating a range of possibilities like shown by Ian for the wall construction. Now it's using a range with all possible configurations. Any way that I can define my own the range, so it's only using values that I'm interested in? And again, solar analysis is available in Dynamo, but is not generating the correct results when you are located in Europe. Any plans to optimize these tools and to get more tools like energy analysis, daylight analysis? So two questions, maybe.
Two questions in there. Sorry, remind me the first one again.
The first one is about
customizing the range.
Finding the range, yeah.
Yes. So that's actually one of the kind of top three requests that we get, and it sounds easy. It's a lot more complex to pull off, and is why we've been working on the back end, because when we allow people to customize what you run there, it will become a more significant challenge to run that service in the cloud efficiently. And just put it this way, because it's one of probably the top three requests, it is one of the things that we're looking at. It's rather complicated to do, but it is in that roadmap of things that we're interested in doing, because we've been asked a lot about it. So it's not currently possible, and the range is fixed. What I always say to people is, don't forget, you've got total control over the BIM setting, right? And the range is just to give you some sense of what some alternative might be, and you can still do that A/B testing where, you know, you do run one and then put something else in the BIM setting and run it. Customization of the range and all that is something that we're looking at as part of future development.
Yeah, there is another question here from one guy regarding the rail stations or rail platforms. So he's designing the rail platforms in Revit, and he's asking if we can run an energy analysis using Insight for this kind of structures.
Right. I just realized I didn't answer Joanne's other question. So the short answer, the other one around solar, Joanne's yes, we're continuing to develop these things around solar.
Yes.
But you're in rail station, depends on what aspect of it. I mean, if you mean a rail platform exposed to the outside, solar radiation will be an interesting tool to look at there, as well as maybe some daylighting. If it's a sort of semi-outdoor sort of space, Beyond that, though, if it was a rail station, like, you know, we're dealing with concourse and things, yes, there's aspects you could do. But the challenges with things like rail, large, very large open spaces, probably with a lot of infiltration and so on, it's probably more of a CFD thing that you would want to look at to help understand the environment a little bit more. It's not really a, a whole building energy thing.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Ian. Thank you so much. So I will review the non-answered questions with Ian, and we'll make sure to follow up with you guys. What's next? The next webinar, tips and tricks, next month, April 26, 11 a.m. So you will receive also an invite and the follow-up email. So the link to the recording will be also sent to you. In the follow-up email, you will have it also in the EP Hub in the next week, for sure. Another thing here I would like to share before we are on the top of the hour. So just if you like to thank Ian about his presentation, please answer the survey. So we'll have a link to the survey for this webinar. I will be sharing it with you in the chat window, and you will receive it also in the follow-up email. With that, I will thank you for your time, and hopefully we can see you next webinar. And again, we'll be posting this. Share your feedback with us, and thank you again for your time. Thank you, Ian, for your great presentation. Thank you all.
Thanks,
thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.